This may be an updated one, but this is, yeah, this is dated April of 99. Ideal for future sex relations, and of course it is with my wife in mind. Be consistently ready to serve her and do so with enthusiasm, because somewhere along the line, I was not of service to a partner, and I didn't like it, and I knew not to, you know. Be a giver, be accountable, notice my impact and power, and never misuse these things. Be consistently available, committed, honorable, loyal in thought, word, and deed. Always make the effort to keep communication open and be a true partner. See, I can partner with her. Never manipulate. Live in reality and form a relationship with God. Honor her feelings, never obligate her. Look only to God for power and a sense of aliveness. See, so much of what we do is a demand for a sense of aliveness. That is a huge trap with us until we come into a relationship with God. And if you'll remind me, I will open this next session with that. It's an important piece of it. Seek God's will and power daily to be part of a healthy relationship. Live my life in such a way that God can love her through me. Be aware of the long term and honor it. And look every day to see who she is. Because she is, Chuck told us, she's not yesterday's woman. She's yesterday's woman plus yesterday's experience. She's somebody different today than she was yesterday. And if I can see that, then I notice I'm somebody different. And I notice she's very interesting. And I notice it's a fresh thing. But I don't want to be doing business with somebody I thought I knew 6 months ago. You know what I mean? There's no sizzle to it. There's no freshness to it. And so, then they took me back to page, the same page, page 69, and said, we got all this down on paper and looked at it. In this way, we tried to shape a sane and sound ideal for our future sex life. And then in the next paragraph, it says, whatever our ideal turns out to be, we must be willing to grow toward it. And I am willing to grow toward that ideal. Do I fall short of it? Sure. But that's my ideal as it existed in April of 1999. If I wrote one today, it'd probably be slightly different. We must be willing to make amends where we've done harm, and I do that with her. Provided that we do not bring about still more harm in doing so, and so on. God alone can judge our sex situation, but it's interesting to notice that I'm now in the realm of intuitive thought more than ever, and it's up to me to frame my own ideal for future. What makes me comfortable in that relationship, in that intimate relationship that's important in my life? And they give us a chance in this book and through this process to articulate that and get it down on paper and look at it and say, here's what I'm about in a relationship with a woman. All right, 10 minutes and we'll come back and do the last session. All right, shall we get, we got one more session to do today. And we'll, let's do that and then we can have another meal. I want to report that a lot of you have gotten over your fear of food this weekend, and that's very gratifying. I want to say Ernie and Don have been come a long way to do this, and it's already been said, but I just want to add my thanks. I know you give up a weekend and you come clear down here for this, and it's very much appreciated here, and I thank you. All right. That sex inventory is, you now know everything I know about it, and it's not as terribly debilitating as you might think. You know, it's a touchy area, and I certainly do not want to get into the kind of detail that is offensive or anything like that. And by that, I mean, I hope what I have said and shared doesn't make you think I've gone too far in it, but I'm just here to report an experience, and it's a very healing experience. The last piece of that is a list of the things that we are never going to tell anybody, and it may involve sexual conduct, and it may involve, as it did in my case, slapping a child, telling that little silly lie that I told that woman that my wife had just died, you know, And there were other things that were on my take to the grave list. But at the end of the inventory, I wanted to make sure that I was had disclosed all of it and put it all on paper. On paper seems to be a big part of it. There's stuff that comes out of the end of that pen that surprises you, you know, when you're writing. It won't show up any other way. I don't think that sometimes guys talk about, well, I'll put it on my computer. Somehow or other, the writing it out seems to be more effective. I don't know why that is. I'll do a workup on a case on a computer, or do stuff, notes or something like that. But when it comes to this, it seems like having a pencil or a pen in my hand is the best way to go. And so you then write down the take to the grave stuff. And now you need to sit down with somebody and read that material to them. And we all know what the book has to say about that in terms of who you select. And typically now, in this day and age, we have plenty of our sponsor is the one to share it with. I think it's important that we share it with our sponsor. In some parts of the country, they'll run off and find a priest and read it to that person and so on. I think it's probably a good idea to have somebody that knows all about you, some one person that knows all about you, that you can share this kind of material with. And while Clancy did not have that first inventory of mine, he's completely up to date on me and what I'm up to. And we have a good relationship today. When I was maybe, I guess, 20 years sober, something like that, I realized that I better form another purpose for this relationship with Clancy, with my sponsor. Because I didn't need him to tell me what color socks to wear, you know what I mean? It was more that I needed a different kind of a relationship, and the only purpose that I could think of that would meet it and keep him in my life was the purpose of being there for him, if that should ever arise. What can I do for you? What can I? And it wasn't long after I formed that purpose that it turned out there was something that I could do for him, and I did it for him in connection with some thing that was going on, and I was always grateful that I could do that, and he always knows that I am there for him, still am. And so I was glad for that opportunity. So the person that we select to read this to is going to be in our lives, and the book makes some interesting comments on it in page 6, chapter 6 at page 72. Vintage Wilson, after you do all this work, on page 72, he finally tells you what the point of it is. Having made our personal inventory, what should we do about it? We've been trying to get a new attitude, a new relationship with our Creator, and to discover the obstacles in our path. Now, what does that mean, a new attitude? And I'm on page 72. They said, if you're in a small plane and you're coming into the guy in the tower, will ask the pilot, what's your attitude? Which means, what is your relationship with the horizon? Are you climbing or diving? Because he wants to look out and spot that plane. Is he climbing out left, climbing out right, banking? Whatever he's doing, that tower guy needs to spot that airplane in a small airfield. What is my attitude toward God? In that same aeronautical sense, all my life it has been leaning away from God. What's a new attitude? Leaning into God. There's a huge difference between a belief in and a dependence on God. And I'd always believed that there was a God, but I never depended on Him. I never had anything going on with Him. And of course, a relationship in that sense takes on a covenant, we're on sacred ground, really, when we're in that kind of a relationship where there's a covenant, where growth is involved, where it's not a barter, where it's not an arrangement. And I think that any good marriage, the relationship is a covenant. It doesn't need to be a marriage, but any good relationship is there's a covenant in it. Like, I'm not only here not to interfere with you, but I'm here to totally support you. And if what you need to do is something that I don't want you to do, then you need to do what you have to do. I'm here for your growth. I'm here for that. And if you need to go back to school and get a, whatever it is, you know, it comes up a lot. And we need to support one another in that sense. So he says we're trying to discover the obstacles in our path, but it's also important to notice that this whole thing has not been a problem-solving technique. The inventory and the fifth step is not one to, it isn't aha, oh, now I see what I've been doing wrong. And it isn't that. It's just to see the truth about how we have lived, the truth about how I've played the power game, the truth about all of my substitutes for God in my life, the truth about where I've gone and tried to get power out of all of these things, just the chronicle of how all of that has happened, and now it's in a form, and there's a lot of pages attached to that. He says we put our finger on the weak items in our personal inventory, and then he says something very interesting. He says, now these are about to be cast out. That's a promise. That's a promise, and it means, I think it means, at step 7, when we say, I'm ready to have these defects removed, take them away. My Creator, I'm now willing that you should have all of me, good and bad. That prayer that we'll get to in a little bit, that's sweet prayer. These are about to be cast out. You can't be having some little bitty God now. We got to get a God with some muscle to him, because these are about to be cast out. But first we have to disclose this material to another human being. And he says there's two reasons for it. The first one is just up about 6 lines on page 72. The best reason first, if we skip this vital step, we may not overcome drinking. And the second reason is at the bottom of page 73. It starts with, we must be entirely. That's the second reason. We must be entirely honest with somebody if we expect to live long or happily in this world. That's the second reason. And then he describes who we should go to. But he says, and I'm back on 73 now, more than most people, the alcoholic leads a double life. He's very much the actor. To the outer world, he presents his stage character. This is the one he likes his fellows to see. He wants to enjoy a certain reputation, but knows in his heart he doesn't deserve it. And so my ego and my image are combined to have me present something to you that is different than who I really am. There's no transparency. There's no ability to just be here and be who I am and report accurately what's going on. More than most people, the alcoholic leads a double life. And then in the next paragraph, he says, the inconsistency is made worse by the things he does on his sprees. They told me to write the word sober above that, sober sprees. Because we can go on sprees sober. It says, coming to his senses. At one point in the book, it says, the grouch and the tantrum are not for us. What does he mean? We can't sulk or blow our top. That's not our answer anymore. And I like both those answers. I'm a sulker. And if you push me hard enough, I'm going to be a blow my top. So I have these sober sprees. What does that mean? Well, you can go on a shopping spree that's nothing more than an effort to get some kind of a sense of vitality. We really need that before we have a relationship with God. I think we're so hungry for a sense of aliveness that we tend to do a lot of goofy things. We were talking about compulsive gambling on the way out here, and I've been told that the compulsive gambler has his moment. It isn't when he won, and it isn't when he lost. It's when he's got everything on the line. There's 10 seconds there, and now he feels alive because it could go either way. Or I have a friend that his business had failed, and he really tried to, it was kind of funny, he decided he had a heart problem. And he read up everything he could on heart problems. And he knew a lot. Got it all on the internet and bought texts and all of that stuff, and he was forever obsessed and sober a long time with his heart and how he's doing. And he got to where he was waking up his wife 3 nights a week at midnight saying, I'm afraid I'm having a heart attack. Take me down to the emergency room. And she'd get up and get dressed and take him down there. And they'd check him out and they'd say, you're fine, send him home. And he told me later, he said, you know, I never felt more alive than when I was on my way down to the hospital thinking I might die. I mean, there's so much I had a friend that had a, he was married and he worked in one town. He had a girlfriend in another town and he'd go see her and then he'd stop at his office so he could say he'd been there and then he'd head down to his house. And he said, on the way down there, some nights I would be so full of fear that I would be met with irrefutable evidence when I got home that I was caught. He said, it was just the most alive that I felt. More alive than being with the girlfriend. That just heightened sense of, it doesn't necessarily mean it's good, it's just, by God, at least I know I'm not dead, you know, because I'm about to get caught, or I'm about to lose everything, or I'm about to die. That kind of contrived sense of aliveness that we reach for after we're sober and before we have a relationship with God. We need that sense of aliveness that it brings, and it gets us into the weirdest darn things, and this shows up in the inventory, and much of that is what we put on our take to the grave list. And this could constitute sprees, you know. Coming to his senses, he's revolted at certain episodes he vaguely remembers. These memories are a nightmare. He trembles to think someone might have observed him. How many times have I driven down the freeway in Los Angeles alone in my car and get into an angry argument with somebody and I'm beaten on the steering wheel, I'm just nuts. And then you come out of the ether and you go, oh God, I hope nobody saw me doing that. You know, it's a spree. It's just free. I'll read it again with that in mind. The inconsistency is made worse by the things he does on his sprees. Coming to his senses, he's revolted at certain episodes he vaguely remembers. These memories are a nightmare. He trembles to think someone might have observed him. As fast as he can, he pushes these memories far inside himself. He hopes he'll never see the light of day. He's under constant fear and tension, and that makes for more sprees. And that's how we live our life. We're just punched through with these kind of problems. So, we must be entirely honest with somebody if we want to live long or happily in the world. And then on page 75, the last sentence that they had me look at before the fifth step is in the beginning of that second complete paragraph. We pocket our pride and go to it, illuminating every twist of character, every dark cranny of the past. He said, that's what we're going to do now. And I'm honored that you asked me to hear your inventory. I will keep your confidence. And he said, there's something else you need to know. As we sit here, God's here too. Disclose to God, another human being under ourselves, the exact nature of our wrong. And God will be here with us. And so I read all of that material. And it can be very helpful if the guy that's here in the inventory kind of gets a sense and begins to make little notes about what old ideas might have been at play. What does this guy have to believe about life in order to be mad at whatever he's mad at? And out of that comes the realization that I never, ever trusted women. You can't trust them because they're going to nail you sooner or later. I'm fascinated by them. I love them. I think they're, but I'm not safe there. I'm not safe there. And all it was something that happened, as I told you, before I was even 5 years old. And it had been long forgotten, but it came floating up. And there was all of that kind of thing. And then you have to, what's an interesting thing, once you have that old idea in place, it doesn't really match with reality. So you have to get another idea cooking that will make the I'll give you an example. I noticed when I was about 8 years old that even though I had known for some years, 3 years, that my mother didn't love me, I noticed she was still there. And that's a little hard to reconcile with what was going on. Well, I've got a mind that is a marvelous thing to watch, and so it came up with another thing, and that is, well, she's there because she has to be there. Now, that would be okay, except that these all expand to include all women. So what does that mean? Downstream, if I have a woman I want to select to come into my life, I know she'll stay, I know she won't love me and I can't trust her, but I'll bring her into my life, and the only way to make sure she won't leave is to bring one in that has to be there. Now, who has to be there? Oh, somebody that can't earn a living. Oh, somebody that has kids. Oh, somebody that is very clingy. Oh, somebody that is, you know, that kind of... And I would bring these women into my life and then hate them. It'd be like getting a dog with brown eyes and then beating it every day because it has brown eyes. You know, it's just like, what is that about? And it's so confusing. And all of this began to kind of float up out of this inventory. I began to see it. I'll tell you, I'm just going to give you a little snippet of how some of these old ideas looked in my inventory. If I can put my hands on it here. I thought I had put it in here. I'm going to have to catch it a little bit later on. But there was, and maybe it's better put off anyway, we were at it quite a while, this reading of this inventory and this fifth step. And God was there with us. And when we were done, He said, "Is there anything that you have not disclosed to me?" And I read my take it to the grave list. He said, "Is there anything else?" And God was good to me because I remembered another thing that needed to be disclosed that hadn't been put down anywhere, and I told Him that. And He said, "I want you to go home for an hour and take a look at what you've done." He was referring to what's on page 75. We can be quiet for an hour, carefully reviewing what we've done. We thank God from the bottom of our heart that we know Him better. Taking this book down from the shelf, we turn to the page which contains the 12 steps. And we review the first 5 steps. We ask ourselves if we have omitted anything, for we're building an arch through which we can walk a free man at last. Is our work solid so far? Are the stones properly in place? Here comes that North New England stone quarry guy. That's his background. And so he talks about skimping on cement put into the foundation, mortar without sand, and so on. I love his language. And so the first step is, we admitted we were powerless over alcohol, that our lives had become unmanageable. Have I been thorough about that? And I could say, yes, I have. Came to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity. Oh, yeah. I did that. Made a decision to turn our will and our lives over to the care of God as we understand. Yes. Made a searching and fearless more. Yes. Admitted to God, to ourselves and another human being, the exact nature of our wrongs. Yeah. I did that. And so I spent an hour going through that inventory because there was some work to be taken from it. First of all, I needed a list of character defects. I mean, the 7 deadly sins is not a bad place to start. The list from the column 4, fear, anger, selfishness and self-seeking and dishonesty is added in there. And then these old ideas that I had spotted. And the question is, have I really made a house cleaning? Have I gone back through my life and turned back the pages and come to see the futility of the way that I'd been living? Not just drunk, but sober for 23 years. By now, it was probably 24. And the next thing he says is, on page 76 at the top, if we can answer to our satisfaction, then we look at step 6. So the first part of this, the first time in this process that we are actually asked to engage our intuitive thought. In other words, if I can answer to my satisfaction that I've done the first 5 steps, then I can go on to step 6. And I knew then that I had done the first 5 steps. I knew that. And it was very clear. I had no problem with that. And I was very grateful. I thank God from the bottom of my heart that I knew him better, because I had looked at and realized that the obstacles that were in my way were nothing more than that. They were just obstacles, and I had put them there by relying on all of these things and many more that had been part of my life. And it really points up how important it is to pay attention to that question as to whether God is everything or nothing, and to answer it truthfully and really get to a point where we can say, yeah, there's nothing more important to me than a better relationship with God. If I can be there, if I can be there, the rest of this flows. And it's painstaking, but it's not difficult. I don't think that God put us in this path to give us a huge, difficult problem to solve. I think that what he did was give us a way to handle our... This is the kind of material that comes up that would take years of psychiatry to reach, if ever. But we set in to force these spiritual laws that we only dimly perceive, and they take us along the path. There's a journey is just a day's trip, and it's really quite a trip. And we're on that broad highway finally. And there is a lot of joy in that. And we become then more inner-directed, more tuned into what's really going on, more awake. There is an awakening that started. There is then the decision of what to do about six. Made a list of our character defects. He uses another word, shortcomings. We're entirely ready to have God remove all of these defects of character. And so they told me to make a list of these defects of character, including my old ideas. These notions about my mom and about my grandma and about my dad and about women in my life and about how it all fit together, about money, about career, all kind of old ideas were there and were just had been kicking my fanny for a long time. And I did that. And now the question is, am I willing to let go of these things? Am I willing to let it go? Am I willing not to have it part of my life? Now that is a big question. And here again, if we don't tell the truth about it, we're going to be in some kind of trouble, because it'll still be there. It isn't that God doesn't have the power to take it out of my life. It's that I won't let it go. I don't want to let it go. Am I really willing to let go of lust, or am I just having a little too much fun with it right now? And sometimes it's a close call. Doesn't seem to cause any trouble. It gives me a fantasy life. What's the problem? Well, the problem is it gets between me and a relationship with God. That's the problem. Is it bad or good? Oh, it doesn't matter whether it's bad or good. It isn't like it's got a moral hook on it so much as, is it in the way? Is it an obstacle? If it is, it has to go. And they had me write out all of these things. Here's just a short list. For me to improve, disaster must be at hand. The genetic pool is defective. I'm flawed. You know, I mean, God, you don't have a chance now, right? Because it's a matter of genetics, and I'm just screwed. Now, I wish I'd had different folks. But I don't. Can't make it. I don't have the time to make changes. They take too long. I can't have a mentor. I can't have money. Doesn't seem like any of that to get in the way, does it? But those are things I knew to be true. I knew them to be true until they floated up in an inventory, and a guy was kind enough to say, you know what? I've written down these old ideas. You take a look at them. They're just my idea of how you must have seen it. And if you own them, great. If you don't worry about them. We had, you know, we're run by 20 old ideas. It's not that elaborate. And they all just repeat and repeat and repeat and repeat. Am I willing to let that go? For me to improve, disaster must be in hand. Am I willing to drop that one? Yeah, it's a good excuse. But am I willing to drop it? Okay, all right, I'll let that go. Am I willing to drop the notion that the genetic pool is defective? Yeah, I have to. To hang on to that one is pretty colorful. I don't have the time to make changes. They take too long. You know, one of the rich things about that we have is that I got sober on the 14th, on the 15th. I was sober on the 15th. That's the biggest change in my life ever. How long did it take? Don't take long. Didn't take long. It doesn't take long to tell the truth either, come to think about it. I can't have a mentor. Will I drop that? I can't have money. Will I drop that? That was harder to drop because of fears attached to having money. I'll lose it and look like such a chump, it's better not to go there. Yeah. But the questions that came out of step six out of the book are these. Am I ready to let God remove from me all the things that I have admitted are objectionable? We're back to what I don't want. It's like the sex image. What is my ideal for future sex relations? All that I have found objectionable. And then number two, if I'm willing that he take them, can he do that? Does he have the horsepower to do that? Or am I still going with a little bitty God that can't get anything done or doesn't care? And I knew the answer to that is, yeah, my God is big enough. God, he took that booze out, you know, kept me alive. I've been all that time, 23 years or whatever it was, 24 maybe, I haven't had a drink. I should have drank 100 times. I didn't drink. That's amazing. How big a God is that? That's a great big guy. That's a big guy. And that's my God now. That is my God. If we still cling, can he now take him, everyone? If we still cling to something we will not let go, we ask God to help us be willing. And this is just like this list here. Take me to a place where I'm willing to let it go, willing to let the lust go. I was willing to reprioritize it and have it less important than a better relationship with God, but do I still have it as a hip pocket matter? On a dark night I may need it, you know? Let it go, let it go, let it go. And you know, you're ready. Okay, you can have it. Then the other question is, will he do that for me, just as I am? Will he take him out of my life if I ask him to, or do I have to get better for him to do that? And the answer was yes to all these questions. And then they told me, if these are about to be cast out, and they will be at step seven, it's important that you have an idea to put in there. What new idea would really please you? I mean, it's a start, you know. A nature abhors a vacuum. You can't have that just taken out and nothing to replace it. And so I wrote up a new idea, and I played with this for a little bit. Here it is. The genetic pool is defective. I'm flawed. What would be the new idea I'd like to have? I'm perfect. The imperfections I've added to protect me are easily allowed to go out of my life. The balance is perfect, absolutely perfect. No hiding, no secrets, no refusal to communicate. I don't have the time to make changes. They take too long. Here's the new idea. The time is now. The place is here. Change is easy. There's plenty of time. Instant change and shift is the way of God and the universe and of me. For me to improve, disaster must be at hand. To kick it up to the next level is a wonderful privilege, and I can do it with reverence and conviction. This is my gift to God. This is my opportunity to rejoice, to celebrate, to say thank you. This I will do as my daily prayer and as my destiny again and again and again. Amen. I can't have a mentor. I can have all the wisdom, men and women, that I can ever need or want. Easily in my life. They are there and will come in. I'll see them and ask. They will offer. They are incredibly valuable. I can't have money. I easily and quickly learn much about money and have great fun accumulating it and handling it with a great and rare wisdom. Now, those are ideas you can take on home, you know, instead of that crud that I created so long ago. I trust and admire the women in my life. I trust and admire the women in my life and know that they are always there for me. And it isn't just my wife, but the women friends I have in AA. I have four women that work for me, and they are wonderful. They are wonderful women, and I trust them and I admire them, from the receptionist to my secretary to the, they're just terrific human beings, and they love me and I love them, and I couldn't have that in my life without taking another look at this, because I just would bounce it out. See, there's spirit and then there's mind, which is sort of like the prism or the filter. And then there's the body, which is the energy control mechanism, which is why it's a good idea to keep it in shape. I do that Tai Bo. I saw one of those infomercials, and I thought, oh man, but I was kind of compelled to it. And I went down and looked at it a couple of years ago, and this guy is for real. And now I'm in there two or three days a week for an hour doing this kickbox thing. And I dropped 25 pounds, and I got toned up, and I feel a lot better. And and it's always a challenge. I'm the oldest guy in there, but they kind of come to know that I'll be the one standing at the end of the hour. It isn't pretty, but I get it done. And the first 20 minutes is physical, and then you got a series of decisions to make about. Am I going to get mad at the trainer or hang in here, you know? Am I going to turn around and look at that clock, or am I going to just stay here and do it? Do I focus on what's going on? Am I going to really replicate what that trainer does? Or am I going to just kind of shamble through it like I've got elastic bands on my, you know? I often wanted to go in there and say, I'm just a medical experiment from UCLA to see if you can use a false leg without the straps coming off. I want to tell them some crap like that. But I love doing it. It gives me a good sense. Anyway, I don't know how I got on that. Because I want to be useful, that's how. I want to stay trying lawsuits, and I want to stay doing this, and I can't be creaking around, moving old and all that, you know. So I like doing what I can to stay in shape, and it keeps things perked up at home, too, you know. It's just a different energy. God was so good to me going through this, and I'm about at this point and about ready to say the seven-step prayer, and I'm up in Northern California at a little conference, and there was a gal named Joyce from Reno that had come over to speak at the conference, and I've never forgotten Joyce, and I've never forgotten what she said. Because we're at step 6 and we're at step 7, and step 7 says, 6 is we're entirely ready to have God remove all these defects of character, and step 7 says, humbly ask Him to remove our shortcomings. What does humbly mean? It means knowing the truth, and the truth is, I can't get rid of them. It isn't about me working on them, it isn't about God helping me to get rid of them, it's about Him taking them. And all I have to do is ask. And so I'm kind of in there someplace. I'm at this conference. Joyce gets up to the podium. Joyce says, tells a great story. She was 20 years sober at the time, and she spoke of a time when she was 10 years sober when she decided that she wanted to get over her fear of heights. And she, you know this, Joyce, and she says she decided to take skydiving lessons. And I'm going, wow, that's pretty colorful. I don't think I'd do that. And she did. She took skydiving lessons, and the day came she's supposed to solo out of an airplane in the drop zone. And she had her husband out there, and her ex-husband was out there. I don't know why he was there, but he was out there. Women she sponsored were out there. Her daughters were out there. They're all waiting to see Joyce come out of this airplane. And it came across the drop zone, and she came out of there, and she had packed that chute but hadn't really done that good a job with it. And the damn thing didn't quite open, and she hit the deck going a lot faster than she should have. And she's up there talking about it, so you get that she lived through it, but it's like, wow. And she's busted herself up pretty good. She, you know what she said? She said, I spent the next 18 months in a hospital learning how to urinate again. And you go, ooh, got it, Joyce, got it. No more detail, please. Like, wow. And she was in the critical care, and then she was in the general hospital, and then months went by, and she's out in the rehab part. And her husband left her. But her ex-husband, this guy, was in AA, and he came by. Good guy. And they spoke one day at length. He helped her with lunch and stuff, and they spoke and talked a lot. And he finally said to her, Joyce, how is it you did that? What was that? And she said, you mean the... He said, yeah, why this guy... She said, well, as you know, I was always afraid of heights, and I thought maybe I could get over it if I did that. And he started to laugh. Not unkindly, apparently, but he's laughing. And she said, what the hell are you laughing about? And he said, all you had to do was humbly ask. Jesus. Whoa! But it gives you a little glimpse of the power attached to this, you know. All we got to do is humbly ask, knowing that we're toast. You want that out of your life? Ask, ask. And so, it goes like this. My Creator, I'm now willing that you should have all of me, good and bad. I pray that you now remove from me every single defect of character which stands in the way of my usefulness to you and to my fellows. Grant me strength as I go out from here to do your bidding. And notice that these, what's going to get removed are those that stand in the way of our usefulness. God chooses which to remove. God chooses. And they will go. They will go. And then he says, he ends this with amen. Here's the amen that we see now for the first time on page 76. We didn't end that third step prayer with amen, but we end this with amen because we've been in prayer. We've been under protection all of this time. And something has begun to stir in us. They told me, as I reported to you this morning, that if I could create a vision of God's will for me, as I came down the pike with these steps and got to step 9, there would be a difference. And we haven't noticed it or commented on it up to now, but there is a great parallel thing between the bedevilments on page 52 and what he says about the promises just a few pages later on page 83. We were having trouble with personal relationships. On page 83 it says, we will lose interest in selfish things and gain interest in our fellows. Self-seeking will slip away. On page 52, we couldn't control our emotional natures. Page 83, we will comprehend the word serenity and we will know peace. Page 52, we were prey to misery and depression. Page 83, Our whole attitude and outlook upon life will change. Page 52, we couldn't make a living. Page 83, fear of people and of economic insecurity will leave us. 52, we had a feeling of uselessness. 83, that feeling of uselessness and self-pity will disappear. 52, we were full of fear. 83, we will intuitively know how to handle situations that used to baffle us. 52, we were unhappy. 83, we were going to know a new freedom and a new happiness. We couldn't seem to be of real help to other people. 83, No matter how far down the scale we have gone, we will see how our experience can benefit others. We will not regret the past nor wish to shut the door on it. And most of all, we will suddenly realize that God is doing for us what we could not do for ourselves. Are these extravagant promises? Oh, yeah. Yeah. And they're being fulfilled among us. Powerful stuff. Powerful stuff. We're going to quit here in a minute. We'll just hang on to this inventory stuff long enough to make an 8-step list out of it, and then talk about the 9-step. And we'll do that tomorrow morning. We'll do 8 and 9, and then a session on two other sessions, 10, 11, and 12, in the morning. And so tonight you're going to have a great meeting, and we'll have a great dinner, and we'll do it that way. And thank you. We are going to do 3 sessions this morning. I wanted to talk about 8 and 9, and probably in an hour, maybe a little bit, the first session, maybe a little more than one session. And then we'll talk about, we'll revisit 10 and 11 after having been through this process, and talk about 12, this idea of carrying the message. We are at a very interesting part of the steps when we start into 8 and 9. We finished 7 up yesterday and began to get a glimpse of what the promises might be. He leaves the expression of those promises until the 9th step. But it's my experience, and I think Gary would agree with me, that it begins to kind of, those promises that are expressed begin to show up, this sense of having a sense of peace, this, the promise of comprehend the word serenity and we will know peace, begins to come. As Pat said last night, and somebody else, about how they felt after that 5th step. Somebody was talking about looking the world in the eye. I can't remember who had that comment to make. And incidentally, thank you for a great meeting last night, Beverly. It was wonderful, and I appreciated that. It was a good meeting. Thank you. The here comes the bus from the treatment center. All right, we got everybody here. Good. Okay. We were talking about the fact that the promises that we mentioned yesterday, I just referred to them at step 7, and I was surprised how touching that was to me to see that contrast, because I'd never really looked at it that specifically, and somebody had set up this counterpoint of the bedevilments and the promises. And they do begin to show up. It says in the book, by the time we're halfway through this phase of our development, and he's referring to step 9, but we notice, I think anybody that can get this, that has the power to move through 6 and 7 and really move through that, even after 5, is beginning to sense that there's a whole new vision and a whole new view of the world available. And we do get a sense of a loss of the feeling of uselessness and self-pity, and we do begin to sense that there may be a new freedom and a new happiness available to us, and that it's coming up. And that's a very heartening thing, because it kind of keeps you moving. It kind of keeps you moving through this process. Many of us get a little afraid of that as we get through step 9. We know how powerful this is, and we've still got an ego that's running around having a lot of fun. It's kind of running around up there like a rat in a cage, and it knows it's going to be out of a job pretty quick. And it'll start to say, you know, right now you have a kind of a unhappy, lackluster life, but at least you know how to get by in that life. At least you know how it goes. And you know that whatever, but if you allowed a wonderful mate to come into your life, who knows what kind of, how would you handle that? You know, how would you keep him under control if he was, if she was really a wonderful person? How would you handle money coming in? Wouldn't you just be, you better not, stop these amends. This is silly. Don't be going there. I can kind of keep you, I've been taking care of you all your life. Our ego gets to chatting pretty good. And they, somebody, and I, who nobody, this is in the who can check department, but somebody told me once that we've had this ego with us as a very important part of our life when we were still in the jungles worried about whether we were going to be lunch for the saber-toothed tiger. And the ego was designed, we didn't have any tools, we didn't have any fire, we didn't have anything going for us at all. We couldn't outrun that thing and we had no way to outmuscle it. And this idea of having an ego was the thing that if you ventured forth out of a familiar part of the jungle, the ego would say, don't go there, danger, 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 because you don't know the safety escape routes and you don't know which branch will carry your weight but not the tiger's. You don't know where the ways to little burrow under there and not be lunch that day. And these little creatures would go out in search of food or in search of a mate, but they'd have to venture forth into unknown territory. And the ego says, danger, danger, and they'd come back into the known territory. And because they did that, we survived. We survived. We were not lunch. Our ancestors survived. And our ego is still treating us that way. Another bus just came in and we need some chairs. Are you guys going to be able to find those? Okay. After this is over, I'll sign your certificates of completion. I had to go to driving school last year and they had all this certificate. They have that around here, driving school. If you get a ticket, you can go to school for a day or something like that. Well, this is like driving school. You haven't finished your amends and you have to be here today. No, I'm kidding. The ego is still with us. And of course, when we surrender, that ego takes a huge hit. But it doesn't go away. And we don't really want to be without it. We just want to... It gets another job, and it should get another job. We don't want to... It would be having my ego run my life, or coming from a relationship with my ego, like we were talking about the other night at step 11, where we're on one side of the page, where we're coming from fear all the time. Having that experience is like... Anybody here have a 7-year-old child in their life? Yeah, your kids, you got kids... Kid 7 years old, it'd be like, and I have grandchildren that are kind of bouncing around that age. I have 7 grandkids. Are you ready for that? Does it seem right? Yeah. That cannot be true. I have to have lied about that. Turn the operation of your home over to a 7-year-old and they're making all the decisions, every one of them. And so then one day Joe comes by to visit and he walks in and he says, nice place you got here. Yeah, it smells funny. Why are these little bowls of milk? Tim, our 7-year-old, is running the house now and we eat every meal on the floor. We eat cereal at every meal and... He doesn't like to do anything else, and we don't wash up these dishes. Oh, how come these piles of clothes are... Tim just says, take them off and leave them where they lie. We don't wash them, we don't put them away, don't do any of that. We just kind of do what Tim says. Well, you got all these envelopes, and oh yeah, we don't pay bills anymore. Tim doesn't like to do that. He just lets all that stack up over there. And Joe would say... give it a rest. Give Tim a new job. Tim's a nice kid, and I know he wants very much to please you, but turning over the operation of your entire home to Tim is not a good idea. It is simply not. It isn't that he doesn't want to do a great job, and it isn't that he won't try very hard to do it right, but Tim is just not... that's not his job. That's not his job. Tell you what you do. Tell Tim to go clean up his own room, and then tell him that you will take him out for pizza and a movie tonight if he does right, and you get busy on the rest of this place, and you supervise Tim. And it gets to be like that. I still have an ego. I talk to it. It gets a little gnarly once in a while when I'm afraid my ego. I'll give you an example. About 90 days, maybe 6 months ago, I had to take the deposition in my work of the head of the neurology department at Stanford University. Now, this is a big hitter. This guy is a very, very big hitter, internationally known guy. And the other side had called him as an expert. I was very jumpy about that because I don't know neurology the way this guy does. And I don't have any way of doing anything but go in there, find out what his opinions are, and then go give them to my expert and ask him what we can say and do about what this guy has to say, so that when we get in front of a jury, this guy's opinions, if they're invalid or there's something wrong or if he's overstating the case, and they will, we can do something about it. But the whole idea made me very nervous. It just made me very jumpy because I went to dental school and got some training in neurology and neurophysiology and some training in orthopedics and some training in biochemistry, and so I know the language a little bit. But when you get down to whether there's a seizure disorder caused by a bump on the head, that is a very, very interesting and spectacularly specialized area. And I don't know that area in any kind of, and what little I'll learn about it will stay with me for a while. But I was very nervous, and I could feel it in my gut. And I couldn't really, I was having, and when I get nervous and start feeling that in my gut, and I get that big lump in my gut, my mind doesn't work as well. And I can't really focus and work hard on that particular area to pick up what I need to know. And so I realized after a while that I was just kind of spinning around, and I asked for help, of course, but I told my ego, look, you get into my subconscious, you bring up all the information that I already have about this stuff and have it ready for me Monday morning, and in the meantime, leave me alone. And just stop it. And my gut calmed down. And I was able to focus, and then Monday when I took that deposition, I was ready for it. I took the information back to my expert, and we had worked up a nice response to it. But it's in every area of my life, and that I will get in and feel over my head, or when I'm, you know, we're supposed to be the agents were described in the book. Instead of considering ourselves the agents of God's ever-advancing universe. In other words, living on the edge, moving, like how we want to shrink back into the interior where it's all safe, which is fine, except the first complaint is going to be, oh, I'm bored, you know, because there's nothing, I know, there's just nothing going on for me, instead of moving out toward the edge, instead of capturing an idea that I might have a mission here in life, and that that mission needs to be discovered by me, and I need to get out on the edge with my mission. And so with the process through the steps and with an awakening, a lot of this stuff comes into view, and we begin to learn to use it in our daily lives, and it doesn't take any energy at all. We begin to set intention, and we begin to work like that. We begin to see that we can be brought along, and that the edge is no more. You know, I saw a bumper sticker the other day that said, if you're not living on the edge, you're taking up too much room. And but we don't like the edge. We don't like to. It rattled me when Linda said, let's give up an old idea. And I went, fine. But I didn't mean fine. I meant, leave me alone, you know. And then she said, you go first. And I, and I could have picked a fight with her and gotten out of the whole thing, right? I mean, it would have been, and it would have been a choice. But We have, I didn't want to do that. The edge is okay. The edge is okay. There's always in giving a talk, if I retreat back to what last year's talk was, I'm in comfortable territory. But when my mind is back there and if I'm given a talk that's 2 years old, my mind starts to wander, really. Because my mouth has given this talk, but my head's going everywhere. And as soon as my mind starts to wander, everybody's mind in the room, have you ever noticed that? If your mind starts to wander during a talk, you can be sure the speaker's mind is wandering. He's not in the room either. And it can be just a fine talk. You hear the tape of it later on. It's just a perfect talk. Nothing at all wrong with it, except nobody was there. Nobody's quite in the room, you know. And getting in the room is a very precious thing. That's what I love about Alcoholics Anonymous. That's what, I don't know where this is all taking us, as a matter of fact. But that's what I love about AA, is that people get me in the room. I remember the first time that happened, because I'm never in the room. I'm sitting here with you, but I'm worried about money, or I'm worried, I was worried. Am I subject to arrest sitting here? Is a cop going to come in here and get me out of here? And you can be anywhere but in the room. And once in a while, the people that were speaking, a gal named Gail got me in the room one night. God, I felt so... she looked like a million bucks up there talking at the podium. The grace and dignity and beauty that AA women had, that wonderful sense of themselves that emerges in such a wonderful fashion, and their power is extraordinary. And she's up there at the podium, and I was new, and she's about my age, and she'd been sober maybe 4 years or so, and I'm like fantasizing about whether she'd go out to dinner with me and so on. But her talk was knocking me out, because she said that she started talking about the alcoholic's prayer, the prayer we make. Gail died some years ago now, but she was talking that night about the alcoholic's prayer, and the scene that she painted was a scene where she was sitting, she came out of a blackout in her living room, sitting up on the mantel over the fireplace with her cat. And an interesting thing, so she's drawn me into the story and into the room. And she said that the reason that they were up on the mantle, and that what they had up there was some vodka and some cat food. That was what was up there with them. So, you know, you get a little more of the scene. And then she said the reason they were up there is because there was 4 inches of water on the floor. And now I'm getting more interested, because instead of this elegant woman, I see that she was at one time a pig like me, just lived in a crazy little way, you know. And of course I wanted to take her to dinner. And then she said the reason that they were up there, and the reason there was 4 inches of water on the floor, was because she had decided to take a bath last Tuesday and the whole deal got away from her somehow. And I'm going, yes! Gail, I love you, Gail. But like, I'm in the room, you know. And then she said, the alcoholic's prayer. Her prayer at that moment. The alcoholic's prayer. Our prayer. Jesus Christ, what's wrong with me? That prayer. And she touched me. Touched me. But I was in the room. And that's the place we probably are at our best. And when we're being what we are to be, we don't often have a sense that we're being that. Which is it, because only an ego needs to know that I'm being my best, you know. And the ego's out of the picture, or I wouldn't be being my best. And so it's like I'm just humming along, not using up any energy, not creating any conflict, not doing anything, but get something really important going with the people around me. And that's why these promises begin to show up as we move along. We do lose interest in selfish things and gain interest in our fellows. And we will certainly begin to see that God is doing for us what we could not do for ourselves. There is a mission that we all have in common, and that is the mission of having the best possible relationship with God, a relationship, a real relationship. And there is a secondary mission that we all have in common. See, a relationship is based on a covenant, basically. And it's always changing. It's always changing. If it's a real relationship, it's always changing, which rattles an ego. That's the reason that we like these arrangements, because they're static. You do this for me, I'll do that for you, and I know what to expect from you, and I know how to keep score when you don't do what you're supposed to do, and you know how to keep score, and back and forth and like that. And it's an arrangement because it's static and it's contractual, whereas there's a covenant to a relationship, and an unconditional covenant. We're going to do this no matter what. One of the weirdest things that I ever did before Linda and I got married, she was raised a Catholic, and she wanted to go to an engaged encounter, which is one of these weekends the Catholic Church puts on for people that want to get married in the church. And I had not had, as I've reported to you earlier, exactly a long, successful career in marriage. I've had a long and checkered career in marriage. In fact, does anybody here know Polans, Howard Polans? Have you? Yeah. Howard is one of these delightful people, and maybe coming through in this area, somebody said, if he is anywhere near this area, if Joe or Pat get him over here, he is really a special human being. And he's about my age and sober, maybe a year or two less. And we were getting invited up to Mackenzie River Bridge in Oregon. And it seemed like 1 year he'd go up there, and 1 year I'd go up there. And I'd get up there, and they'd say, oh, Howard was here last year. And he was just wonderful. He was so wonderful. Sort of like the subtext is, you really got something to live up to, Hodges, you know. And then I'd see him on Wednesday night pretty regularly, and he told me when he'd go up there, he'd say, oh, Clint was up here last year, and he, wonderful, wonderful. And he's like, oh, good, thanks for sharing, you know. I really need to hear that. But I love him, and he loves me, and we had some fun laughing about it. And then they ask him, he's been married to his wife Pat, a delightful Al-Anon lady, and they were asked to go up there to that area to put on a retreat about relationships. And so I saw him, and I was kidding him. I said, "It's shocking to me they would ask you to go up there. You know they like me better than they like you, Howard. And besides that, here you have, what do you know about relationships? You got that one relationship with that woman you fell in love with in kindergarten, and you've been with her ever since. And it's just, you don't have any rich experience." Now me, I've been married four times, been with a lot of, and by God, they really blew it this time, telling you to go up there and do that thing, when I could have really brought a lot of in detail to them. And we just laughed our heads off about that. But the point is that there is in a relationship something that endures, but it has to have a lot of breathing room. It must have that. It must have that because it is like for growth. And when we all know that feeling of being with somebody that is outgrowing us, and how scared we get. Somebody that looks like, man, she's found some peace in that area, and I'm still struggling with it. And am I going to support that and bless that and love her more for that, or am I going to get afraid that pretty soon she'll be looking at me like I'm somebody that ought not to be in her life? We all know that a relationship requires that we be awake. We have to wake up to be in a relationship. I have to look and see who she is every day. And if it's not a relationship, if it's an arrangement, I settle for order. I want order in my life. I want to know that somebody is going to do this task, and I'll do this task, and somebody is going to be there, and you're not going to say this, and you are, you know, we got to go into a little subterranean arrangement where I won't call you on your crap and you won't call me on mine, and we'll just let it go at that, and we're not going to bring any of that up. And we like the status quo rather than intimacy. And I always wanted the status quo, and I always wanted order, and I always wanted the predictability, and I always complained because I never had any intimacy. I was with Tom Whalen one night at dinner, and I had another marriage had failed, and he said, "What happened this time?" And I said, "Well, she just couldn't be intimate." And he's just, his voice actually rose in irritation with a lot of other people in that dining room, and said, "Who couldn't be intimate?" I said, "She couldn't be intimate." He said, "How many marriages have there been?" I said, "Four." He said, "What is the common factor in all of those marriages?" And he didn't even let me answer. He said, you're the common factor in every one of those things. They've all failed. You know, a little wake-up call. How much order do you really want? Do you want a relationship, or do you want something that is just like locked into a..." And the truth of the matter is, sometimes I just want something that's very predictable. But I'm learning that that's not where my happiness is, and that's not where the intimacy is, and that's not where it's going to be a lot of fun. And in order to get there, I had to do a lot of work in amends. And so we'll finally get to the subject of the morning. Step 8 requires that we make a list of all people we have harmed and become willing to make amends to them all. And so they said to me, what you do is you go back through your life. Not just these inventory pages. Not just that. Although there was plenty of material on those inventory pages. But there was something else. And that is, what about the high school annual? What about the organizations you belong to? What about the Pacific Group list? What about the list from the AAs around the area? What about the stuff that came out of college and out of relationships with other people in the same profession I'm in? What about the California trial lawyers? What about that list? There's some people there. And they made me see how valuable it would be to go through your Christmas card list, they said. Go through all these kinds of lists. And of course, you know, having a Christmas card list is sort of a luxury in sobriety. You know, it's not like I got here with a box full of Christmas cards and lists and things like that. I didn't have that. I had some boxes of sheets that were not in very good shape, and a radio that played all the time. But you acquire things like Christmas card lists when you stay in one community. I went through all of those and I came out of there with a list. And they were people that I had not thought about in a long time that I realized I had harmed. These are not the people that I resented, although some of those were on the list. But there were some people that I did not resent that I had harmed. And I knew I had harmed them. And the list, and sometimes the harm can be subtle, but it's very real harm. Like... one of the overriding things I realized with the women in my life is that I had taken their dignity away. I had taken their dignity. I had tried to reduce them by whatever means I could. I had tried to... because I had all of these old ideas, as we were talking about, Keenan mentioned it last night, I'm not a woman hater, but women fascinate me. I'm just afraid when I'm up close to women. It terrifies me. Terror is not too strong a word for an event that comes out of your childhood like that. Because as a little kid, you just, life as I know it is over. When I got slapped like that day, when I got beaten that hard, I knew she could not love me. I knew, you know, all of that kind of stuff that we go on and on about. But I made this list, and it of course started when I was young, the people that I had harmed. How had I harmed my mother? I'd embarrassed her. Primarily, I set about to embarrass her. I set about to embarrass my dad. That's the only way sometimes a child can really punish somebody as a male authority figure, is to embarrass them as publicly as possible in an area that they know is important to them. It's a list, and just a list of names. And we may owe an amends to an institution like the dental school or the Marine Corps or whatever. But it's a list of names. And that list of names is the start. And then they told me to get some 3x5 cards. Because the inventory and all of those pages that were the inventory, it's now time to dispose of it. To respectfully dispose of the inventory. Not to keep it in my life. It has been very useful to me. It's given me a means by which I can honor my resentments, because my resentments take me to the truth. When I can see what I resent, I can see how I've been living my life. It's my inventory, and it's now served its entire purpose when I use it to take away my, to list my people to whom I owe amends. And so I will, some guys burn their inventory. I didn't have anything fancy to do with it, but I remember that he said, take it in a respectful way. And so I just put it in a bag and respectfully put it in a trash can, but consciously, no, thank you. This has been very useful. And let it go out of my life, out of my life. Some guys get a little fancier, and they, one guy sat in my place and burned his inventory in the fireplace. It took him forever. I thought we'd never get there. made quite a thing about it. But I got these 3x5 cards, and I transferred each one of these names to it. And up here I put the name, and I put the telephone number up in the upper left-hand corner.